pay you out.
Okay. I'm sure you have a reason.
Well, we used to have it that way, we changed it. Good evening. Calling this meeting of the Wendell Board of Commissioners to order. Want to thank you all for being here. We have a nice full house tonight. It's always nice to see. We have a lot of folks here. We are going to be led in the Pledge of Allegiance tonight by Antonio Lester, who is a student at the Wendell Creative Arts and Science Magnet Elementary School. Antonio joined Wendell Elementary School last year as a fourth grader and has been an asset to the school. He is the host on the segment Character Corner on the Daily Morning Show. He was selected as host because he's one of the most polite, respectful, honest, and hardworking students we have at Wendell Elementary School. That's very nice. That's for high praise. He consistently makes good choices and puts forth his best effort in everything he does. He also serves on our safety patrol team. Antonio is a great kid all around. He is truly a soaring eagle in the heart of Wendell. That's very high praise. I'm sure your family is very proud of you. So you want to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. Have a seat with your family. Our invocation tonight is Mr. Bob Fleming from the Covenant Presbyterian Church. Thank you for being here with us tonight.
Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the many blessings you've bestowed upon us. We know that your blessings also, if we serve you as we should, give us responsibilities. And our responsibilities are you, and our serving you is by serving our fellow man. We pray that as we meet tonight, that we will be fully aware of your guidance and that we will be guided by your principles as taught in the Holy Scriptures. Be with each of our leaders here, and may they be fully aware of your presence. These things we pray in your name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you again for being with us. We have one, I need a motion to approve the agenda. Or is there any adjustment to the agenda?
Motion to approve.
All in favor?
Aye.
We have one person signed up for public comment, Ms. Regina Horman.
Good evening, everybody. My name's Regina Harmon. I'm here tonight just to give you a quick update on the Wendell Chamber of Commerce. Commissioners, Mayor, Ms. Piner, I dropped off a book to you guys earlier today. Some of you seen it this weekend at the Pro Tem bike event. This is a little book that the Chamber has put together in cooperation with the town, the business people, as well as the Park and Rec, where we could let folks in our community know some of the wonderful places we have in our town to go visit, along with some coupon offers. Some just great business leaders have joined with us to put this together. The Park and Rec and the town, you guys are working with us to get this passed out at local tournaments and events, so outsiders coming to our town will know where to go and to stay here in our community and not go elsewhere out to eat, various things like that. So it's a privilege over at the Chamber of Commerce to be working with you on that, so thank you so much for your help. Another thing that we're doing is a spring fling. I know I mentioned it last time. We're over halfway there filling that up. It's coming up soon. We're partnering with the Appearance Commission through the town of Wendell on that event. We're looking, you know, forward to it. We've got a lot of the details worked out. That is on May 13th. May 13th, and it's going to be from like 9 to 7 o'clock. So please come out and join us for that, those of you that are watching this program. And the last thing that we're working on over at the Chamber of Commerce right now is the annual golf tournament. That's coming up May the 19th. We did it on a Friday this year for all of you folks that want to have a three-day weekend. So, you know, join, come out, get a team, sponsor a sign, just get involved, come have a good time with us and everything like that. It's on May the 19th. And we're also partnering with the East Wake Educational Foundation on that as well. So we're real proud over there at the Chamber this year. We're working to partner with a lot of organizations to help them help us. So far, it's been working out great, and we really do appreciate everything you guys are doing to work with us. So thank you. You guys have a good night.
Thank you, ma'am. Do you have a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Motion to approve.
All in favor?
Aye.
Item number four is recognition of Wendell Creative Arts and Science Magnet Elementary School teacher Abigail Hodges. Ms. Hodges, can you come up here? I'm going to tell y'all a little bit about Ms. Hodges. Abigail Hodges is Wendell Creative Arts and Science Magnet Elementary School's 2016-2017 Teacher of the Year. Ms. Hodges joined Wendell Elementary School in 2014 as our science specialist. She quickly became a member of the Wendell family. Ms. Hodges helps our students and teachers be excited about science and hands-on learning and is constantly working to improve student learning. In December of 2016, Ms. Hodges volunteered to take a vacant fourth grade English as a ELA classroom position to help staff and students. Ms. Hodges exemplifies our school's mission and vision and is an asset to our staff in town. I want to congratulate you for being selected to be recognized here by your principal and staff at your school, and also for being the 2016-17 Teacher of the Year.
Thank you. That's outstanding. It's an honor.
Well, I also want to thank you for all that you do for our kids in Wendell. Thank you very much. Doesn't go unnoticed.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Item number five is recognition of interim principal Mike Chappell at Wendell Creative Arts and Science Magnet Elementary School. You want to come up here? I think he's going to tell us a little bit about what's going on at Wendell Elementary.
I am. Thank you, Mayor Gray. Wendell Elementary School is about the 10th school I've been an interim principal in the last 5 years since I retired, and absolutely is my favorite. I can say that former principal Shane Barham and his staff, Angela Armstrong, our assistant principal who's here tonight, just a great staff to work with, and I have thoroughly enjoyed it. This is my last week at Wendell Elementary. We will have a new principal join us on April the 10th. But I'll give you a little information about the school since I've been there anyway. Wendell Elementary currently has about 550 students, a very stable staff, very little turnover there. It was named a Magnet Schools of America School Distinction for another year. Our new principal is Jack Zelmer, and he will be joining Wendell Elementary on April 10th. He is currently an assistant principal at Wakefield Elementary School. Our dance and choral students, we're very proud of. They performed at the Wake County Schools Pieces of Gold recently. And also, they will be performing at the Stars of the East that's coming up in April next month. Also, we recently hosted a regional A-plus arts meeting. Wendell Elementary is an A-plus arts school. And we also had a tour group from Texas to come up and tour our school last week. See how Wendell integrates the Creative Arts and Science Magnet School program. So we're very proud of everything that's going on over there, and again, it's been a personal privilege and pleasure for me to have been at Wendell since January.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for being there for us.
Thank you.
Thank you. Item number six is the presentation of life-saving award to Wendell Police Sergeant Brian Hare.
Good evening, Madam Mayor, members of the board. I have a great privilege, probably one of the greatest things I've had a chance to do in my tenure here, and that's to present a life-saving award to Wendell Police Sergeant Brian L. Hare, or Landon as we all know him. On Saturday, October 31st, 2015, at about 3:55 in the afternoon, officers of the Wendell Police Department were dispatched to a home in the 500 block of Oakdale Lane in reference to a 3-year-old child that was unresponsive. Sergeant Hare was the first to arrive on the scene and found the child laying on the floor, not breathing. He began life-saving measures and determined that the child had food lodged in his airway. Sergeant Hare was able to free the food from the child's airway, and the child resumed breathing. The child was transported to Wake Med Center for further evaluation and made a full recovery. The Wendell Police Department has a peer-driven committee. Has a peer-driven awards committee that reviews actions such as the one outlined above. Nominations for the awards can be made by peers, and the details of the officer's actions are presented to the committee. The committee then votes and makes a recommendation to the chief of police with regard to the award. In order to be eligible for the life-saving award, an officer with the Wendell Police Department must meet one or more of the following criteria, as quoted from our manual. Must be directly responsible for saving the life of another human being, or actions by the employee led to a prolonging of life to the extent that the victim was released from medical care. Evidence supports that the officer was directly responsible in that action. Documentation and other supportive evidence, such as statements from physicians, witnesses, and or supervisors, will be included in the original recommendation for this award. The actions of Sergeant Brian Landon Hare were reviewed by the awards committee, and it was a unanimous decision that he be awarded the Wendell Life Saving Award. So first and foremost, Sergeant Hare, I'd like to present you with this award. And for a really special moment this evening, I'd like for someone to come up and help me. This is Brandon Lee, folks. This is who we were talking about. Brandon?
Something you'd like to say?
It's just a pleasure working for you guys, and I was so thankful I was where I was at the time. It's a kid, you know?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I want to congratulate Sergeant Hare, Landon, as we all know him. I think you know that your efforts that day have impacted this family for the rest of their lives, and evidence of that sitting right here looking at me right now. So that was a good day's work. Thank you. You made Wendell really proud. Thank you. Is it customary that we take a little recess after we did so they can take some pictures and things? But let's take about 5 minutes.
Let's go, dear. Let the happy crowd clear out too.
What other bills you got going on tomorrow?
Or fully the Homestead Act is what it is for veterans. Homestead Act for firing parts.
That's fine, and I think that's.
I didn't even know that was a thing. I never heard that.
You also have a shared ride on the side. Up because I'm afraid if I sit down for any longer than 10 minutes, I'm just going to fall asleep, man. It's been a long couple of, it's been a long month.
Yeah, that check for that land, that's what I think.
I gotta know, man.
Where'd everybody go?
Yeah. They want to hear me. They cleared out.
That's time for you to go.
I understand.
All right, we're back in session. Item number 7, discussion on potential amendments to the town's economic development incentive policy. Mr. Bergmark.
Thank you, Mayor, members of the board. This is a continuation from our January 9th meeting. At that meeting, this board reviewed our current incentive policies. Staff talked about some of the limitations as we saw it for our current policy, both for large industry as well as small. So from that discussion, we've crafted some draft language just for your consideration tonight. So really, we're just looking for some feedback on are we headed in the right direction or not, so that we can prepare more final material for your consideration. What you have is broken up into two categories, your a large business incentive policy, as well as a small downtown focused incentives, options for you to consider. I did want to point out that for the downtown, we are using that DMX district in the way it's worded right now as the boundary for eligibility. The board could look at changing that. You know, people, when they say downtown, they mean different things. They don't necessarily mean exactly where that district lies. But if we were going to go outside of the DMX for anything like that, we would probably have to create some kind of defined boundary. So just a brief reminder, right now, large business incentive grant, it starts at for $1 million in building or up to $2 million in building and land, and it's equivalent to 75% of the local tax paid to the town of Wendell over a five-year period. We were looking at changing that because that's just a low threshold that essentially any commercial, even the McDonald's or anything, just about would qualify, and we don't want to find ourselves in a big hole because every new commercial that comes in essentially is only paying us 25% taxes over a five-year period, or the equivalent of it once we both pay each other. So that's why we're looking at changing that policy. And let's see, for the small business, right now the incentives are quite small to the point where we don't feel like they actually incentivize anything. If you're looking at a $300 or maybe $500 of reduced fees, that's not really going to cause someone to come and open up a business here or to expand their business here. Everyone was eligible. There really was no eligibility. So what we wanted to do is propose some specific grants that would be more directed at what we wanted, where we wanted it, but more substantial, where we felt like that actually would cost somebody to invest in a building where they might not otherwise do so. So I'll go through I kind of created a bullet list in the report. That's what I'll go through, and if you want me to go into more detail in any specific one, I can do so. So for large businesses, essentially what we did was in the proposed policy, which we took that 2009 policy document, which had a little bit more meat to it and more process, and we modified that for this draft. We raised the minimum investment from $1 million to $5 million for new businesses, and that's for both building and equipment, but not land. We have the incentive grant is equivalent to 75% of the assessed value on the new investment, paid out over a four-year period, and that percentage is reduced by 10% each year. So it's the biggest amount up front, but then the town gets a little bit more each year as that percentage goes down. We then created a tiered system to offer more incentive to larger businesses. So for the $25 million investment or a $50 million investment, we then increase that percentage so it'll go beyond 75 initially, as well as we increase the duration by a year for those two upper tiers to 5 years instead of four. There is an employment eligibility as part of this too. So it starts out at requiring a minimum of 15 jobs, paying at least 75% of the county average wage. Under the old 2009 policy, it actually did have a wage requirement, and it was at 100% of the county average wage. Well, that county average wage is just over $50,000. We felt like there could be some where, you know, if you're paying $40,000, if it's a lot of jobs, it's a good investment, we might want to include that. So that's why we lowered that threshold just a little bit. And also includes requirement for health insurance premium coverage of at least 50% of those costs for new businesses. And then similar to how we did with the investment amount, for those larger investments, the number of jobs go up slightly to 25 jobs for the $25 million investment or 50 jobs for the $50 million investment. The eligibility for what types of uses this can go towards, we took from the 2009
language. So it was limited to manufacturing, industrial, distribution, and office and service industries. It did not include retail, so this couldn't go towards like a super Walmart or something like that, really focusing on more industry and more employment centers.
Quick question, hate to interrupt, but
yes, sir.
Is a movie theater considered retail or is it considered a service?
I don't think that was the intent in service. I'd have to look back. I don't know if it's actually written more detailed than that, to be honest, but would you like it to be included?
The question is there going to be businesses that come up and say, well, no, I'm not retail, I'm service, or I'm not, you know, this, I'm that. And so we might need to get a little more granular.
I think you're right. I think we need to define those uses more closely than they are right now.
Okay. But, yes, I would like to know about, movie theaters.
And as one reminder, I should say this to begin with, this is all based on all at the board's discretion. So just because something's listed as eligible doesn't mean that the board has to approve anything. But it is good to set a solid groundwork so people have a general sense of expectations when they're applying. There was also, and this was in the 2009 language, there was a business expansion grant for $1 million or more of investment with at least 5 new employees as part of that. That was, you got a grant equivalent to 75% of the value of the new investment over a 4 period, and again, it's reduced by 10% each year. And if it was a $10 million or more investment, it went up a little bit, both in percentage and duration. Any other questions about the large business before I get into the small, kind of more downtown options? Okay. So for the downtown, we gave you several different things to consider. One of those would be, and I know there was kind of mixed feelings about this, but we included language in here for your consideration, a downtown Wendell residential incentive grant, which is a one-to-one matching grant, as proposed up to $7,500 for creating upper story residential units within the DMX district. The way it's written right now, would be paid following the certificate of occupancy being issued. Again, the idea is just that creates kind of a constant presence of patrons in the downtown helping supporting those businesses.
Is that per unit?
Is it, sorry, say that, per unit for the 7,500?
So, yeah, if they put basically 2 apartments above a building, would they be eligible for 2 of those, or is it just per project? Is that a max 7,500 per project? I just love throwing wrenches at you.
Yeah.
Today.
No, these are good questions. In fact, I'm going to write that one down. I don't think you'd want to do it as per unit. I think that could start to get too cost prohibitive if somebody. Not that we have many buildings where you could really put a lot of units in. But I think that the way that was structured was really meant to be more per property, per parcel. But I'll verify unless you have a. But again, if the board has a preference where they. To me, that would be a much bigger benefit if it was per unit than I think it was meant to be.
Definitely need to clarify it.
Yeah, my feeling is that should be kind of a per parcel at a minimum. Then there was also a downtown Wendell redevelopment incentive grant. So this one actually looked at improved value. Not all these necessarily look at increased tax value. This one, you had to at least improve the tax value by $50,000 to be able to be eligible. And if you did so, then there was kind of a sliding scale of the grant amount. So at $50,000, you were eligible for a $10,000 grant. At $100,000, it could go up to $10,000, and it could actually get up to $20,000 for the highest amount. And this would be something that essentially, if you applied and was approved, we would wait until the next tax assessment occurred, verify how much the increase was, and then you would have payments going out over a split up over a 3-year period based on the amount. This is probably the largest incentive out of any of these. What we try to think about is what would actually cause somebody to go and spend, $100,000, $150,000 in a downtown building. And if you're just throwing $2,000 their way, if they're already going to do it, they may take it, but that's probably not going to incentivize them to do something. If you're throwing $10,000 their way, then I feel like that's a real incentive. I don't know how the board might feel about that, but that was the idea behind this, is to create a more bold incentive to really cause something to happen. Facade grant we just threw in, we hope the board would consider funding that. You could also structure it where if you wanted to emphasize the downtown, you could have that matching amount as greater than the rest of town. We also had a restaurant upfit assistance grant, which was a matching grant as structured up to $30,000 for upfitting the building in the DMX district to serve as a restaurant. That one's also paid out over 30 years. And finally, a downtown retail upfit grant. This is something we found in Raleigh. It's a little bit like a facade grant in a way. It's a 50% match up to $5,000 for upfitting the building in the DMX, but it doesn't look at just the outside, just the facade. It can include interior improvements as well, and it requires a lot of information to be submitted, and kind of looking through it, such as photographs, renderings, contractor information, business plans, proof of funds. So it's not just about upfitting the building. It's also making sure that the person who's moving in and going to be operating that business has a sound plan and is more likely to succeed over time. So it's kind of also about you're rewarding people that you the types of business managers that you would want as well. So like I said, that's just kind of the real quick and easy overview. You have the full wording. For those that you like, we would flush them out a little bit more as well. But before we spent too much time in one direction, we wanted to see if there are certain ones where you just said, no, we don't like that idea at all. And a lot of these were taken from other towns that might have done similar operations. I think Concord was one of them.
Does anybody have any questions or comments for Mr. Bergmark about the draft?
I have a few comments. just off the cuff, I'm not sure how many takers we'll have on the residential incentive grant. There are a few buildings downtown that I think could be upfitted for, apartments on the second story, but I just don't think there's a whole lot of room, for that to really take off. The Wendell Redevelopment Incentive Grant, the one where if tax values increase, I think Commissioner Carroll will tell you that you don't have to spend $50,000 to increase your tax value by $50,000. So that could end up being a nearly, as it stands at $50,000 and you get a $10,000 grant, that's, 20%. But that's based on tax value. You might be able to get it. It might come in closer to 25, 30, 35%. If someone upfitting a building were to spend money in the right places. So I agree. I think that one would probably be utilized a lot just because it is a very large a large grant. The facade grant, I don't know that the facade grant ever got anyone off of the fence as to whether or not to improve the front of their building. I think it was something that was there that was nice, and it was taken advantage of by numerous businesses downtown. I'm not sure it pushed anyone over the edge to improve their storefront when they weren't currently thinking about doing so. So I'm not really sure about the facade grant. But if you ask people in Wendell what Wendell needs downtown or what the town government could be doing to improve downtown, 90% of the time the answer you get is we need somewhere else to eat. We need more restaurants. We need an Italian place or a steakhouse or this or that or the other. The restaurant upfit, I like that. 50% up to $30,000 is pretty strong. I'd like to see some more stipulations on that, it has to be the same owner that upfits it is the only one that can claim so we don't have people coming in and flipping properties just to get the grant, whatnot. I'm not sure how to, flesh all that stuff out. That's not really restaurants and building improvements is not really my wheelhouse, but that That's a pretty strong one, but I would like to see something that would incentivize restaurants, because that's the number one complaint I hear. I don't know what everybody else hears, but it's one of the number one complaints that I hear about downtown. And the retail upfit grant, being limited at $5,000, I think it would be a little bit less of a burden if people took us up on it. I'm not real sure about that. I'd like to hear a little bit more about that. But the restaurant one's the one that really piques my interest. So that's just, you know, off the cuff, that's just sort of where I stand on it.
I'll just speak to kind of follow up what he said. I agree with the restaurant grant. I think something that looks nice. I think the goal for me, or at least my thought, was always hoping the facade grants, people would take some of their building fronts and upfit those and make them look nice, like some, a lot of businesses have done. Whether the facade grant will accomplish that or not, I don't know. It seems like we've had a little bit of a lull in getting people to apply for that for a while. It was every month, but it seems to jump off. Yeah, so I don't know if we need to, sometimes when it's kind of lost its luster, kind of scratch it and mix it up a little bit, but I still would like to try to do something to incentivize or push some people to try to improve the outward appearance of their buildings. The first two, I don't have much concern with. I still would like to see more from a small business incentive policy. I think something like that to entice small businesses, or just businesses that are here to improve what they have would be, I think, could kind of go along with some of the other grants you have, even in the NEMEX district. And then even the large business policy on that one, I still feel like the 7.5%, I still feel like it's really a large number. We always talk about needing more tax base and industrial or commercial being that base we need more of, and to incentivize is nice, but then to incentivize and then I feel like give it back is working against ourselves a little bit. So
that's part of the reason why we had it go down by 10%. Actually, right now it's just 75% across, you know, for a 5-year period.
Yeah.
But we could look at if that's the consensus of the moment board.
I guess if and I don't know what this is, and you guys probably would better than I, that number, which is going to be incentivizing, but you know, win-win, I guess, for everybody.
Anyone else?
David, is there a way, I can't find the language in here, if there is, but where I could qualify for both number two, the redevelopment, and like the restaurant outfit?
So yeah, that's definitely something we'd want to flesh out as well. I do know that in one of these, I think I had it written that you could not also qualify for another, but we would definitely want to make that decision of, could you only be capped at one? I mean, right now that's an open question at the discretion of the board. I guess it depends on how much you really want a restaurant. Would you want somebody to be able to double dip, or just say that 30,000 is enough?
It depends on the restaurant.
Yeah. I think if we leave it at 30,000, then they probably should be double dipping. But with that,
probably should not be.
Right. So with that being said, if a restaurant comes downtown and we pay them the 30,000 over 3 years, if they don't stay, the next tenant that comes in, are they eligible for the grant as well? Well, or if the restaurant doesn't?
Well, it's for upfitting. So are you asking if somebody came out and then like pour out what they had and put something of their own in?
Well, I think you're being really optimistic on the 3-year, you know, lifespan of a restaurant.
Well, the payments would, if they leave, then the payments would stop, because you're paying that out over time. You're not paying
so
it.
So the next tenant would be eligible for the 30,000 as well?
They would have to spend the money, so they have to come in and spend another.
Which is not hard to do in a restaurant.
I suppose someone new could apply, but again, unless they're now upfitting it differently, your agreement was with the prior tenant, and they upfitted it. They okay. stayed for a year. They got paid for a year, and then they left. Now you could decide, well, what if that restaurant leaves, but a new restaurant tenant just moves into their space? Could they then be a recipient of the remaining funds of that original grant? You could do it that way, or you could just say, sorry, no.
They spent the money to repaint and
change
the building. Would they be eligible for the grant?
You could do it either way. You could say that no, we're not going to award it to the same building within a set period of time, or you could say we're willing to consider that. But Yeah, right.
I wouldn't want to, I mean, and I understand what you're getting at, but I wouldn't want to close that loophole. There's a specific restaurant right now that I think any of us would probably put the money up if somebody wanted to if that was going to bring somebody in.
Right.
But I do think there needs to be some sort of restrictions on it, because as it's written right now, it says for upfitting a building in the DMX district to serve as a restaurant. It doesn't say for an existing restaurant to buy new appliances. So if there was a building that was already a restaurant and they needed a new $10,000 Viking range, then the town wouldn't be on the hook for $5,000 to replace their range. It's for upfitting the building. So in my mind, that's for stuff like, kitchen-related fire suppression, hood systems, oil water separators for the drains, upfitting sewer lines and things like that. And if upfitting the building includes putting in new appliances, then that's fine. But there may need to be a minimum on that too, because if every time a restaurant's oven breaks or something else, we're going to be looking at paying half the bill for that. So I think it might need to be limited to upfitting the building and whatever kitchen equipment's bought at that time, and not just, wear and tear. If we're fleshing it out,
Can we leave a caveat in there that if the building's currently vacant or has been vacant for greater than 3 months, that way you don't have to worry about, I understand we don't want to, isn't the downtown subsidized,
right,
currently existing upfit grant. This is the fill our empty spaces with restaurants grant. So anything to achieve that goal that you think is wise, certainly defer to our
I don't want to get to the point where they're changing tenants every year or 2 years or 3 years, and we're paying $10,000 a year at the max incentive grant to have a restaurant.
Well, they'd have to spend $20,000 a year to keep that going.
It's not hard to do in a restaurant.
I'm sure it's not.
I'll again just point out, you can say no. I mean, like, none of this is granted. Even if it says you spend this much, you're eligible for this. I think we should frame it a little bit more than it is. But the board always has the ability to say we just spent X amount 2 years ago.
But there needs to be parameters for that too, so it doesn't look like you're picking and choosing who you say no to. Because then you said no, you let her do it, and now you're not letting me, and you know how that kind of thing can get. So I do think there needs to be parameters. And I also think a consideration is that sometimes restaurants, when they leave, they take things with them.
Yeah. They could take all the kitchen equipment out.
The kitchen equipment might be gone, everything but the grease trap that's in the ground.
I mean,
so,
you
what do you do then?
I mean, you could, that's a good question. I mean, you could limit it to equipment that, can't be removed and taken off site. I mean, they're not going to rip out the fire suppression. But then again, that equipment costs quite a bit of money.
Right.
So that might be, I don't know if you want to limit to that.
Upfitting means a lot of things. It could be tables and chairs. It could be all kinds of things. So I think that's certainly something to think about. As far as the residential incentive grant, I kind of like that. I know we don't have a lot of places for that, but if you look on 3rd Street, I was kind of going up and down in my head, and, I can count 4 or 5 spots, and it's definitely an economic development boon to have people living in your upstairs and your downtown. So even though we don't have many, I would still like to have someone living in the few that we do have. So I like the idea of that. The modification within the BMX about the, we already just talked about that, the facade grant. We haven't had a lot of people apply for that lately, but that's because we haven't funded it. So, I think we can make the decision whether or not we're ready to fund it again. We have had some growth and some interest in the downtown recently. That's kind of, things go in cycles, and it's kind of back, and it might be that we would decide to fund the facade grant again. I do think that the purpose of it certainly is to improve the looks of the downtown, but it also kind of puts a little bit of peer pressure on folks for their neighbors, and people kind of want to do things because the people next door to them have done things, and it gets you get a lot of bang for your buck out of the facade grant. I mean, every economic development conference I go to, they love the facade grant, so there's a lot of good with that. And then the downtown retail upfit grant, I like the idea of that too. There's a lot of things that I would like to have in the downtown, so clearly I'm ready to do whatever we need to do to get people down there. Does anybody else have any comments on that, the downtown part? And we'll talk about the large business incentive policy.
I have one quick question.
Okay.
Commissioner Lutz, you made a comment about, you know, small businesses, and was your point that you would prefer to see something that could be for an existing business upfitting, but something much, or existing business making some investment, but not at the level that would be qualifying for these other grants? Because the downtown retail upfit grant, you know, that's supposed to be something that's helping out a little smaller, but that is for someone new moving in. So I can see your point right there, that it's not for, not an existing retail store isn't going to be able to qualify for that.
Right. I was thinking more along the lines of if a business in town that's already here was going somewhere other than the downtown, I guess, the downtown area, you know, remodeling an old building, building something new, something like that, where they were still, you know, improving the overall economic status of the town. I feel like there should be something more to incentivize them or to help them along that process. I'm more sympathetic to that from that standpoint, so I feel like that would be a little more, it'd be something nice to have. I think there's a lot of good small businesses in the town, and if we can keep encouraging them to grow and to stay here and to, I think that helps everybody.
That's kind of where I feel like the facade grant falls as well, to just get people to, you know, you don't want to forget about the people who have stuck it out with us while we're trying to encourage new, and new will certainly help those people who've been here all along, because the more you have, the better it is for everybody. I don't want to forget those people who've been here, and that's where I think the facade grant is important, and I think that's what maybe Commissioner Lutz was talking about.
Mm-hmm. I just think it's something part of this speaks to the, yes, part of this speaks to the DMX district, which is wonderful, and I think I'm a huge proponent of the downtown area, but there are other areas of town that will receive growth and need growth as well, too. So
I didn't really hear any consensus of we don't want to see any one of these at all. Different people had some different comments, but should I basically, obviously there's more interest in the restaurant upfit. We need to flush out more on that one. I'd say that I didn't really hear anyone against that, but are there any of these I should not bring back with in a more finalized form for consideration?
I would register a little bit of concern about the residential upfit, but feel free to do as you wish. As far as bringing it back to us, we can sort that out later.
What concern do you have about it?
I don't believe it's a true economic development engine. I think we'll get a grand total of 14 people living downtown that otherwise could live within two blocks. I mean, we're always downtown because we're always around downtown. I don't know that $7,500 a pop, you know, so if we have seven units that may be available, it's $49,000, so that's a cent on the tax rate, and I don't know that we'll get that back out of the improvement in driving business. I'd love to see them develop, but I think if we focus on getting those buildings down, getting the restaurants in there, that you'll have people develop them because they'll see a benefit in it. I mean, I'm more than happy to see what you come back with and discuss it later. I think
any kind of growth down there is good, and it's good for everyone that's down there.
Would it make a difference if it was open to the development of a new structure in the downtown that had residential above, residential above commercial or something like that? I mean, we've really talked about the existing building sitting there, and there's not that much opportunity within the DMX, but there are some parcels that you could potentially redevelop.
I hadn't really considered new. I was just thinking of the handful that we have down there that are empty.
And would that be your
life down there, because it's dead down there sometimes.
Is there a preference of the board to just keep it at that?
I don't know. What do y'all think?
I think it's worth casting a net out, looking at more in depth. And if it's something we come back and we feel like it's not our favorite, we can scratch it there.
New construction, it might would get away from us, like Commissioner Joyner.
Yeah.
That might would get away. I mean, to me, what was appealing about the buildings that are already there is because there are so few. And
okay.
Do you have any other questions?
I guess just now about the large business.
Do y'all have any questions or comments about the large business policy?
And we are going to be, I sent these comments to Dan Klausner with Newland as well, just to see if he had any comments. So if he does, which he likely will, I'll share those as well.
Thank you.
David, I got a quick question. Is there going to be a cap put on these payouts on grants on an annual basis, like with the facade grant we funded so much, and once they were applied for and awarded, when the money was out, it was done? Is there an annual cap?
So you could do it either way. You could go ahead and budget a set amount for some of these things, like for the downtown, retail one. You know, you could budget $5,000 or $10,000, say we're not going to spend more than that. Or if the board wanted to pull that out of savings, you could. That's kind of at your discretion which way you want to do it. Also keep in mind that some of these are paying out over multiple years, so it's not necessarily being paid out in the given year that it's being requested. Or you could also set it so that the payout will, you could kind of structure it so the payout would automatically be in the next fiscal year for some of these, so that you could go ahead and then budget for it in your budget cycle.
Sure.
Any other questions? I definitely like raising the minimum investment from $1 to $5 million.
And we even considered, should we go to, is 5 appropriate? Should we go to 10? But I did kind of a search of manufacturing and industrial uses that fell between the $5 and $10 million range.
Right.
According to their assessed value, and just saw what would pop up. And there were some, medical office buildings that, were $7 million that I didn't think we'd necessarily want to just pass on. So that's the reason why we left it at 5.
Well, this might be something we would reflect on again at some point in the future.
Oh, certainly.
All right. Any comments?
All right.
Item 8 is status update on the Wake County Transit Plan implementation steps.
So I serve on the TPAC, Transit Plan Advisory Committee, that's working on the transit plan on a number of different factions and in a number of different ways, and they've created kind of a primer little update presentation that they've asked us to present to the board. So I want to kind of quickly go through that with you all, and also bring to your attention that there is going to be a regional meeting that's being held this week over in Zebulon that I'll be attending. This is kind of more influential for some areas than others, but I will be there for anyone that has questions to citizens. Also to bring to your attention, and I'll hit back on this later, that there are some documents that will don't need your signature now, but that would eventually have to be approved by this board in the next few months. So I'll hit on that at the end of this presentation as well. I just realized this is not a PowerPoint, so I'm going to have to scroll. So essentially, as you know, Wake County Transit Plan was passed. That included some new funding sources. There was a half-cent sales tax that was passed, as well as some vehicle registration fees to add to their existing funding sources. This started back in 2015, but didn't really get passed until 2016 in all its forms. This includes regional connections, both for rail as well as express routes and connections to RTP, making sure we're connecting all our communities, trying to expand our frequent bus service in the kind of the core, and just creating overall more access than there is right now. That's really more about connecting to RTP, so I'll skip by that. And this is getting at your connections to your different towns. We're on the far east side there, and that's really our existing express bus route service being shown in that orange color there. That's really the core, so I won't get into that, but they are looking at trying to create 15-minute bus service within kind of more of your downtown carry area. Additionally, they're looking at creating community funding areas that are shown in those green colors, creating some matching funds that will be available to different municipalities to create their own local circulator systems. And so that's something that we could take advantage of in the future as well. Again, everyone's involved in the TPACs, the organization I mentioned before, and they're working on things like public engagement strategies, implementation plans, looking at what kind of studies need to be done first, putting together material language that says how the community funding areas would be organized and implemented, things of that nature, and doing surveys. There are three agreements that would have to be signed by this board by June at the latest in order for us to be a participant in this and be receiving funds as part of this. As part of this whole agreement, essentially, we're no longer going to have to be paying for that, our existing service. And in the work plan, it also would include payments that we're still paying for our park and ride lease costs. So the, as proposed in that, in the work plan, essentially we would get reimbursed for those costs for our park and ride lot. The three agreements are kind of overarching over themselves in a way. You have a kind of a broad participation agreement that defines the roles of all the parties and the TPAC that organizes it. And then it gets scaled down. Part of this agreement would also say one of the new funding sources is the vehicle registration fee. And by agreeing, by signing these agreements, we're essentially saying that each local municipality is agreeing to give up vehicle registration fees to be funded into this bigger pot and then administered as laid out in the Wake County Transit Plan. Right now, that only matters for people that actually run their own transit services, like Cary and Raleigh. So it doesn't really matter to us now, but if someday we had our own transit service, we'd essentially be saying that that transit service, it would be part of this overall transit plan, so we wouldn't collect those funds. Instead, those funds would go to go to the kind of big transit pot and then get redistributed as it laid out in the plan. And then the final agreement is kind of the more specific municipality by municipality agreement for specifically what you're requesting in any given year. So the transit park and ride lot reimbursements, we'd have an agreement specific to that in that annual capital or operating funding agreement. Like I said, you have some draft material for two of those. They're still being tweaked, but I just wanted to give you a heads up before I come to you in May and say, here's three agreements that you're going to need to sign. This is kind of some organizational material as far as how this all implementation is organized, going through the TPAC and being informed by Campo and Go Triangle, going for the different town boards, and then the agreements being signed by all the participants. I'm going to skip by that. This timeline's a little bit off now, but to let you know, the half-cent sales tax actually doesn't begin until April of 2017. And again, we're looking in the May-June timeline to adopt the work plan, the FY18 work plan, as well as the different agreements that we, as well as the other municipalities, have to sign. And then they begin on implementing small elements. So that initially what they're looking to do is try to create what studies do they need to push forward now? How do they create more stronger regional bus connections? In some cases, they're going ahead and purchasing new buses. In other cases, they're looking at studies for commuter rail going from Garner to Durham. What are some of the low-hanging fruit for expanded services on existing routes? They're, of course, still funding those existing express routes. And these are all projects that are, for the most part, are not here. But again, for us, the big benefit is they'd be reimbursing us for park and ride lot, and they'd be creating a pot of money that we could look to for a circulator bus in the future if we so wish. And I won't go into all the revenue versus expenditure side of it, but it's a lot of money that's being handled by the TPAC and by this group. So you have, and the full annual work plan is available on the waketransit.com site if anybody wants to take a look at it. But like I said, for now, I just want to kind of give you a touch base with where we are now. They're looking at this, trying to adopt this work plan that would lay out what are they going to spend in the next fiscal year and trying to get outreach on that. Be happy to take any questions you may have.
Any questions for Mr. Bergmark?
David, can you forward this, send this presentation, email it to the board after the meeting?
Sure.
All right, thank you. Item number 9 is update of board committees by town board members. Commissioner Lutz, Triangle J.
The last Triangle J meeting, there was discussion mainly on the House Bill 436, and a resolution was drafted in opposition for this bill, and that was about it.
Okay, thank you. I attended CAMPO. We took care of various housekeeping matters and things, and we actually saw this very same presentation regarding the implementation of the Wake County Transit Plan. There's a series of public meetings. If anyone's interested, the one for this area is this Wednesday from 4:30 to 7 at the Eastern Regional Center in Zebulon. So you can go to that and see the same presentation and ask any questions that you may have at that. And that was what we actually did at CAMPO. Item number 10, Commissioner's Reports. Commissioner Joyner?
Nothing tonight, Madam Mayor.
Commissioner Boyette?
Go Ducks.
Commissioner Myrick?
Nothing tonight.
Commissioner Lutz?
Nothing tonight.
Commissioner Carroll?
No comment.
All right, real quickly, the deadline for citizen board applications is April 4th. That's coming up. If you have considered applying, I sure wish that you would. Our boards are all full this year for the first time in a long time. I'm real proud of that. And we have some folks rotating off, and we'd love to have you join us. So give that some consideration. You can do it online, or you can come and do it in person, whichever you'd like. Since we last met, I attended the North Carolina Recreation Parks and Association. They met and held a workshop here in Wendell, and I welcomed them to Wendell. It was a wonderful opportunity to showcase Wendell and let them see the things that we have here. We had a lot of compliments and things. I was real proud of our community center and our staff and folks. I want to thank them for doing that and creating opportunities to have people come to Wendell. For Arbor Day, I have participated in a lot of tree planting this year, one to go still, but our tree board has planted a tree at Wendell Elementary School, Lake Myra Elementary School, Wendell Middle School, the Wendell Community Park, where they planted two, and we will be planting a tree at Carver Elementary School next Friday. So they've been doing a lot of tree planting this year, as always. Also, the Perennial Garden Club and the Wendell Historical Society kind of went in together, and the Garden Club planted a tree on the site of the old post office, just right outside the door here, practically. And I appreciate them doing that. It's always nice to see various groups working together and doing things around town. So that was nice, and it was done in honor of Arbor Day. I want to thank Philip Smith and the Tree Board for what they've done. He works very hard on that program, and he works very hard on engaging the children on that day, on those occasions when he's there. And it's really fun to watch and listen to some things that they say. It's very funny. I also attended the Wake County Mayor's meeting. At those meetings, I don't usually talk about that here. For some reason, I just gloss over it. But we have a chance to hear things that are going on in other municipalities and share things that are going on in ours, and discuss challenges and successes and things like that. And it always makes me feel real good about Wendell when I go and I hear how things are going in other towns. And I mean that in a good way. We're right in track with everyone else. Last thing, this past Saturday, we held the ProTown BMX show. It was very successful. The second show, much more crowded than the first. Businesses in the downtown, the ones that I have spoken to, have reported to me that they had a significant increase in revenue that day and a lot of new faces, and that's the whole point, bringing people to town to see what we have to offer. So that being said, do I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
All right, we're adjourned.